Hi, I'm Alyssa Ford Morrell. I'm an Extension Master Gardener with the Master Gardeners of Northern Virginia. Here today to talk about an invasive plant, mimosa tree. But before we start talking about the mimosa tree, let's make sure we're all on the same page about what an invasive plant is. The definition was set down very solidly first in 1999 when President Clinton signed Executive Order 13112, and later when President Obama signed Executive Order 13751 in 2016. Those orders together say that an invasive plant is capable of escaping cultivation, getting into the wild, and causing harm to the economy, to the environment, or harm to human, animal, or plant health. The mimosa tree, or Albizia julibrissin, also known as a silk tree, is a very pretty tree. Let's just get that out there up front. When I was 4 years old in Los Angeles, my parents bought a new home. It was just being built, and the first thing that my parents did was to go find a landscape designer to design a whole beautiful yard, which was my mother's pride and joy. She requested a number of different plants, including a mimosa, because it was so pretty. It's a beautiful tree. It has feathery leaves and flowers that are very fuzzy pink, really quite an attractive tree. Fast forward to much more recently, here on the East Coast in Arlington and Alexandria and a number of parts around here, it has been named as an invasive plant. Its invasiveness is mostly because it sets a lot of seeds, and the seeds really sprout really easily. Not only that, but the seed pods can last for up to 10 years, believe it or not. Those seed pods, if they're near water, can float down a stream and the seeds will land on the stream bank and sprout. They erode the stream bank quite a bit. You'll often find mimosa along streams that are not well tended. The plants really grow a lot. It's hard to keep up with them. Also, if you try to cut one down, it very easily resprouts. It spreads vegetatively and resprouts anytime it's damaged. So the mimosa tree is a challenge.
Baby mimosas can be pulled out and young trees may be able to be dug out, but mature mimosas should be cut a few inches from the ground and an appropriate herbicide immediately applied to the cut stump in order to kill the roots.
Fortunately, we have some great native alternatives to the mimosa tree. We're here with the first alternative to the invasive mimosa tree, and this is our native serviceberry, Amelanchier arborea. It's a beautiful tree. It blooms in March and April with beautiful five-petaled white flowers. It actually got the common name serviceberry because in the very cold, snowy areas where they couldn't bury people who died in the winter, they knew that when the serviceberry was in bloom, that it meant that the ground was thawing and that they could have the services for the people who had died over the winter. This tree is native through much of Virginia and through the eastern seaboard. It has lovely leaves that come, you know, green lovely in spring and summer, and turns a beautiful color in fall. So you've got the flowers, you've got the leaves, and then you've also got wonderful fruit, pomes that are edible to people. I've eaten them, they're very tasty. If you think about a blueberry that's a red color, you're in the right ballpark. They're very tasty. The problem is, if you want to eat them, you're going to have to fight off the birds and animals who really love to eat them also. It's a great supporter of all sorts of wildlife, birds, even hosts some Lepidoptera. The biggest challenge with Amelanchier is that it is in the apple family and therefore is subject to what's known as cedar apple rust disease, which is a problem that happens only when there's a member of the apple family and a member of the cedar family. When the two plants are near enough each other and the disease is present, then unfortunately what can happen is that the fruit, right when it's ripe, develops this kind of rust that hangs off of it. It looks really kind of disturbing and you wouldn't want to eat it. It's not particularly harmful to the tree, but it is going to affect the edibility of the fruit. The tree grows to be 15 to 25 feet tall. It can take clay soil. It likes moisture, but can take some dryness. It's really a great tree as long as you don't have a lot of cedars close by. Our next alternative to the invasive mimosa tree is here at the Glen Carlin Library Garden, where we have a beautiful fringe tree, also commonly known as old man's beard, Chionanthus virginicus. It's a wonderful smaller tree that can grow 20 to 35 feet tall. It's slow growing, however, and so it isn't going to be the one to shoot up really fast. It is stunning in late May to early June when it blooms, and it has these gorgeous white blossoms that hang down like, as the name implies, an old man's beard. It's a dioecious plant, meaning that it comes in both male and female. And the female plants, after the bloom, will, if it has pollination services from a male nearby, the female plant will set wonderful drupes that are, they look like olives. And in fact, this tree is in the olive family. It is a host plant for a number of different Lepidoptera. The one in my own yard is the tree that animals, birds come into for shelter. They fly in, they take a moment, look around, and then they go where they want to go and come back to the fringe tree when they're done. Our third native alternative is the eastern redbud, Cercus canadensis. It's a tree that is fairly common with really great reason. It's a really great tree. It is tolerant of a whole range of conditions from sun to shade. It grows to be up to 30 feet tall. It has these fairly dark trunks that contrast really well in the early spring when it goes into bloom, and it tends to be a bright pink to almost fuchsia color bloom that's very heavy and very dramatic. The little flowers are actually edible, and so are the pods that they set afterwards. They're in the pea family, and you can see that in part by the shape of the pods and by the shape of the flowers. This tree exhibits something that's quite unusual, and it's called coliflory, and that is that the buds are known to come not only out of the tips of the stems, but even out of the trunks. And you can see there were flowers here on this piece of trunk, and sometimes there's flowers on even very old bark. It is a delightful tree to have, and it is unfortunately susceptible to deer browse and antler rub by deer, and there are some diseases that it is susceptible to, but it's very easy to grow and plants itself quite easily. It doesn't like to be transplanted once it's very large, so the best advice is to get one that's pretty small and let it settle in. Whichever native alternative you choose to invasive mimosa, I wish you happy gardening.